I want to tell the story of Great Hucklow Unitarian Chapel for the last, I suppose, last 3 years, really. I'm a relatively new trustee, but actually looking at our trustee body now, I'm the, I think, second longest serving, the other being from 1987. So we've had a massive turnover in trustees at the chapel in the last three and a half years. So I want to sort of touch on six areas of the chapel's work: services, Sundays, membership, involvement, inclusion, and projects. Essentially, you will all know of Great Hucklow, and I suspect most of you have been there and know it intimately. But the trustees and I essentially inherited a chapel with what we call a residual congregation, with strong finances, with a building in immaculate working order. But not really with a congregational activity base. So over the last few years, we've been exploring and unlocking what we do with the chapel and how we make it work. I think it's probably fair to say that in the context of Unitarianism, it's quite hard to maintain a chapel in a rural setting. And Great Hucklow, if it's nothing else, is rural. The village, I think, has no more than 89 houses. So trying to sustain a congregation from that village is quite a tough ask. So I want to unlock the package of what we've been doing and how we're trying to make worship and social justice and our relevant role in the community come alive, I suppose. If we go on to the next slide, please, Lizzie. So the opening words which we use for this presentation, A Passing Stranger. In the corner of the graveyard at Great Hucklow, there's a stone to a passing stranger, dated to about 1920. It is said this was a man described then as a sort of tramp who was walking past the chapel and in about 1920 dropped dead and died and was taken into the chapel grounds and buried. It sits in the corner of the graveyard, slightly unnoticed. It's often lots of people who have been many times don't know it's there, but it seems to me it's a great symbol, not only of our desire and willingness to take people in, but also of our own role and status. So we've developed what we call this sort of Hucklow prayer, and we use it at the beginning of most of our services. And it seems to me to sort of just touch on that sense of we're all passing through Hucklow, but we're all passing through life. And you'll see in this photograph, we've got heather and some bracken laid on it. Once a year, we go up onto Kinder Scout and collect some heather and lay it on the grave there, partly as a symbolism, partly in order to create some sense of tribute, but also to reflect that actually many of the things that went before matter, and they matter a lot. And it's important for us in the here and now to sort of touch on what we do. So, moving on to services. If we've been sort of toying around with how to do services, and when we started recommencing services, we just decided actually we just needed to commit. And so after a bit of toying around, we do the first Sunday of each month at 11 a.m. Now, this is usually led by myself or by another individual, and we have a set theme. But we put to it a certain test, which is that we were not prepared to put on the service unless the worship leader is prepared to sit in the chapel on their own. We have understood and accepted that we don't have a regular congregation who come out in large numbers, but we will, as a point of principle, always lay on a service on the first Sunday at 11 a.m. There's always a theme. It doesn't necessarily require an organist or a pianist, though sometimes we do have one. It is primarily poems and prayers, but also in order to pick up the rural nature of it, we use quite a lot of the walking and travel guides, and we'll come back to that. I've now been leading this for best part of 2.5 years. I've never done a service on my own. There has always been one other person. And in the last 7 months, people have started appearing who have not been per se invited, who we weren't expecting, and who, until they walked through the door, weren't necessarily on our list of Unitarians. So just by having the regularity of a service each Sunday. Now, for me, personally, I suppose it's important because it means I go regularly to the chapel. It is always sort of looking open on those days, but also it keeps us with a commitment that worship shall take place. This is a place of worship. There are other uses, as I'll come on to, that we're unlocking the chapel for. But I think it's really important that we make the commitment that worship shall and does take place. So in terms of Sundays, however, if we move on to the next slide, I took the wisdom of Ernest Baker on this. He said, Ed, stop worrying about Sundays. You should worry about the other days of the week. And so taking that principle, in fact, I'll get there as early as possible on a Sunday. I automatically opened the front door of the chapel and wedge it open and put the board out saying we're open and there will be a service. But I'll then often busy myself with other tasks around the chapel. But there's some things we have to do on a Sunday, and I'll often use it as my day of work. I recently was about to close the chapel. It was about 12:30 or so. And for those of you who know it, I saw a couple of walkers sort of tumbling over the stile at the end of the wall where the chapel is. And I just called out, did they want a cup of tea or access to the toilet? And in no time at all, I had 37 people, as they appeared over the stile, queuing for the toilets. Actually, having the chapel open for their use, if no other, seemed to me a fruitful use of the day. I soon was doing a tour around the chapel. They were having a look around. They were quizzing me about what Unitarians were. And actually, if you sit outside the chapel on a Sunday, quite literally, tens and sometimes hundreds of walkers, ramblers and cyclists go past the chapel door. So actually, I think we've got a role as a place to visit, almost as a destination. And in that sense, that passing stranger who lies in our churchyard becomes real to the people who are quite literally passing us every day. When people come and use the toilet, get a cup of tea or have a look round, they often ask what are very basic questions, but for Unitarians, sometimes quite difficult questions. You know, what is Unitarianism? Who worships here? What sort of God do you have? And I find myself in those conversations working out what is our story? What is our offer? And I realized that the chapel had to speak for itself beyond simply being a chapel. There had to be things in and around the chapel that were visible and palpable that told the story. And I'll come back to that principle on how we try and tell the story of the chapel. I think it's really important that we have some story, but sometimes it's quite hard to do. So in terms of our memberships, we have theoretically on paper when we began, we didn't have a membership structure at all. So we realized we needed to construct a membership, but with Great Hut Clough, because so many of you know it so well, we had to do membership in a way that enabled people who know and love the chapel, had an affiliation with it, but also people locally could connect to it. So this is a bit of very specific detail. And we chose these words really carefully. Now, I'm not one to read off a slide, but I think I will just take you through this. The chapel is important to the village, to the wider community across the Peak District, but also within the Unitarian, UK Unitarian movement. People choose to become members because this is where they choose to worship. They have a particular affiliation. Some people are married there. They support the role the chapel has within the local community. And then the last line here, we are pragmatic, inclusive, and untroubled by multiple affiliations that anyone might want to sustain. Now, in putting that in, and we then distributed membership forms throughout much of the village, that we are untroubled by multiple affiliations has enabled about, I would say, four people in the village to join us, and they occasionally worship with us. But they are also helping, assisting in other religious venues within the Hope Valley and North Derbyshire. So I think there's something important about laying out quite clearly who is your membership. Some chapels I've been involved in don't actually have a membership, but as a result of us bringing in the membership form, and this is part of that form, we've gone from what I suppose on paper was no members, so we had a residual congregation, to 14 people who have now filled out our membership form and said they wish to join. And I can say hand on heart, of those 14, I've seen, I think, all of them at worship in the last 3 months. So it's, they're not just joining because they like the chapel. We're setting up a Friends of Great Hucklow Chapel separately. But for people who wish to join the chapel and be a member, we have started now paying our GA dues as a chapel with more than 12 members. So if we go on to the next statement about the membership of the chapel. Now, this is where we thought it was a good opportunity for us to lay out quite clearly what sort of worship we conduct. This is an inclusive church. On matters of equality, we consider ourselves to be progressive. We do not and never will conduct services that are negative. The Unitarians have a long tradition associated with dissent, the rights of women, a free and open pulpit, and we understand this draws the chapel into spheres of public policy and government. And then in order to lay out where we were going, we use that as an opportunity to state on issues such as climate change, mental health, poverty, food sustainability, and other topics, we are willing to be a community that champions social justice. We wanted to take this chance, I suppose, to lay out very clearly that we will on some occasions campaign, we will be pushing, we will be advocating certain viewpoints. And in the second bullet point, we recognise the role of Jesus as a teacher to enable those who see God as a key part of their faith life, and we provide space for each person to explore their spiritual journey. Now, in many senses, I think Unitarians don't see those statements as particularly controversial, but I've become very, very aware that for some people they are highly controversial. So I showed these to the local vicar in Tideswell, and they were a little taken aback at the boldness of them. We've signed up to the Church of England's network on climate change in the Hope Valley, and they're actually being far bolder on climate change to an extent and far more upfront about it than we are. So I think there is some learning to be done, but in setting up the membership, one of the people who joined from the village said that they were really pleased we were being so bold on poverty. And I think it's really interesting that it actually, by laying out these statements so determinedly, it gives room for people to A, consider where they're coming from, and B, give them room to have their own doubts or even to explore their own feelings. So the membership bit, I think, is really important. We're up to, as I say, 14 people who have said that they consciously wish to be a member of Great Hucklow Chapel. Now, Hucklow, as I say, is a very small village. So our next step is to start to reach out into the neighbouring communities, Bradwell, Eam, Tideswell, and start to try and get contact in each of those, and possibly even members. I am aware, however, that that takes us into a different sphere, which is actually people travelling to come to the chapel. Now, I do that myself from Chesterfield, but for most people, I think driving to the chapel in the area of North Derbyshire, a lot depends on where you live and where you naturally travel. So quite a lot of people who live in, say, Tideswell will often look to Buxton or even Stockport or further afield. And what I'm wanting them to do is to get Great Hucklow onto their radar as a destination for their worship on a Sunday and on other days. It's become obvious, however, that for some people, Great Hucklow is a place they've never heard of. It's quite possible to live in Derbyshire for quite some time. There are hundreds and hundreds of villages. And if you don't know Great Hucklow, and you're not in that Unitarian tradition of the holiday home, then actually, for some people, it's where is it? So, in getting members of the congregation and in starting to build that up, we then want to move on to how do we involve them? This has been quite tricky, but I've been following an adage which my mother gave me, which is giving people a job enables them to mess it up, and it's crucial to growing as an organisation. Anyone who knows me knows that my instinct is to do it myself. And I realise that's not the answer. But we want people to know that they can help. We don't want to look desperate. We want to show our gratitude. So it's trying to find small tasks and jobs for ways in which people can help and assist. I rarely, if I can, buy things for the chapel. I'll often ask and appeal. We have a very, very active Facebook page for the village. And if I want anything, we recently wanted a rake to sweep up the leaves. So I just put in the Facebook group, does anyone have a rake that the chapel can borrow? The person lent us a rake. I used the rake. As she came to collect it, she said, I really ought to join you now. I've been meaning to for some time. And if I hadn't asked for a rake, I would never have had the engagement in the first place. And it sounds daft, but in a place when the history of the chapel is fairly well known and its importance and existence is obvious to the village, I need to find ways for villagers to reconnect with us or to choose to connect with us. There's a group in the village called Community Spirit. It's essentially social activities. They do the Christmas light switch on, they organise the village fete. And trying to connect with them. So often we act as the storage point for lots of the electrics that they have during the year. And several members of the village are key holders. I've been gradually headhunting various members of them. So we did a quite a big remembrance service in November, and I asked certain key members of the village Community Spirit group to read at the service or to lay wreaths or to participate. And we've been gradually extending that. And so the parish council will then ask to lay a wreath. And this year we involved the borough and county councillors. Now, because this is quite a rural area, Great Hucklow is one village of many. So the county council is actually the county council of Bakewell. Now, by involving him, we then start to get a conversation about people who live further afield than the chapel. So it is, however, very, very hard to try and go village to village, finding people who support us. But actually, by involving, for example, the county councillor who lives in Bakewell, it then meant that we got some coverage in the Bakewell media, that the county council had been and he'd laid a wreath, and here was a photograph of the chapel doing that. It's not significant, but it does all add up, and it gives us some confidence that what we're doing is beginning to grow. Now, in terms of involvement in the chapel, I'm very aware that many of the people who are getting involved in things we do are not chapel folk. Their instinct would not be to spend an hour on a Sunday coming to our service. Their instinct would not be to spend an hour on a Sunday coming to a parish service, but they are willing to assist with activities. So when we've had big services and events, we've been doing them outdoors. So when we reopened the chapel after the pandemic, partly to play to COVID and partly to say the extent to which we had been excluded from the chapel because we shut it, we did the service outdoors and we were blessed with 40 minutes of good weather, and then went into the chapel to light candles and essentially to process through. When we did the remembrance service, we did it outside. We laid wreaths, we hooked them on the walls, and then the children led us through the chapel where they laid out their own wreaths, which were paper and cards, so needed to be indoors. And I think it's twofold. One is we're using the space outside, but second is I don't want to assume that the people I'm asking to help have to be in the chapel as worshippers. I want them to give them an event that they can engage with the chapel and then find that actually we're not difficult or problematic for them spiritually or in terms of worship. By doing them outdoors, it enables them to be involved without being intimidated. And I am struck by how many people are, am I allowed to go in? Do you mind if I go and look? There's a hesitation. So I want to make sure that that door is open. Now, in terms of inclusion, this is my next slide. One of the things we wanted to do was to make sure that it felt like it was a space for everyone. Now, the photo you can see in the bottom corner reveals something of how the chapel looks at the moment. Quite literally, I think I took this last week. And I think it's fair to say, even though there's no one in the photograph, the chapel looks busy. So one of the things we've done, I realised that it risked looking clean, tidy, dusted, but empty. So you can see in this photo quite a few things. So we have the flags flying, partly because it removes the conversation. What sort of chapel are you? Anyone walking in seeing the rainbow progress flag knows instantly that we are probably, and in Nick's case assuredly, pro-LGBT in terms of communities. That's the Derbyshire flag on the left, and you'll see the Union flag and the flag of St George and England just to the middle right. The chapel pews are actually, and I'm sure this isn't unusual, notoriously uncomfortable. So we did a bit of an appeal for cushions, and groups that have been at the Nightingale Centre and some local residents have been dropping cushions off. Actually, it makes quite a difference, I can assure you. I was there last week doing a service, and just having a cushion to nuzzle into in this weather makes a big difference. And then I don't know if you can squint and see in the back two left-hand rows, there are currently piles and piles and piles of teddy bears, and I will explain those when we come back to them. And then to the front right of that photo, you can see the table on which we have loads of chalices. It enables people to make a choice as to which sort of chalice they light, but also we ask people if they want that they can take the chalice home, so they end up with a home chalice. We keep a little bit of a register of people who want to worship at the chalice but can't get there, and I will often either telephone or Zoom or using WhatsApp do a small video service for the four or five people who can't get to the chapel but still wish to have a service. Now, anyone who walks into this chapel and sees it as it is now assumes, and I think accurately, that there's quite a lot going on. They see the cushions, they see the flags, they see the teddy bears, they see the multiple chalices, and it doesn't look like an empty chapel. And I'm very conscious that we are small numbers, but actually the sense that things are happening and the sense that there's lots going on is really important to people's own confidence in signing up to it. We had a new worshipper on Sunday last week, and she said, gosh, you've been busy. Last time I came here, it was empty. Whether we have or haven't been busy, whether or not it is or isn't a charade, it gave her a sense that actually things were going on and this was something she could join to. Now, in terms of social media, and I think this is really important, I use Twitter and Facebook as our two primary means. We're very lucky in having a very strong Facebook page for the village. And I decided that while I could use that, it was more important that we had our own identity a little bit wider. So we now have things that go onto our own Facebook page and then into our Twitter account. When we did our service for Remembrance, because we were doing our first Remembrance after the pandemic, as it were, we included the Eam Village in our celebrations and our service. And so we asked the Eam Museum of Plague if they wanted to lay a wreath at the chapel. Now, given that there is the story of a pandemic, they were absolutely delighted and came along, and it's given us quite strong links into the village of Eam next door, which is actually bigger than Hucklow, probably four or five times bigger. And actually, I discovered that three or four villagers in Hucklow themselves volunteer at the Eam Museum. So why do these things matter? I think they matter because we're sending out a message that the chapel's doors are open. They're not just open to people who are Unitarians, but open to people who care about a range of items and issues that matter to them. But also, it might be a chapel which is useful to them. So if we move on to the next slide, which is sort of the biggest single thing, we've identified a series of projects, and they are all suitably unlikely and suitably dark. So Armistice Day, virtually every chapel, I think, will do an armistice service. But we decided to make quite a big thing of it. So we asked the children at the school in the run-up to Armistice Day to make wreaths and prepare poems, which they did. And we then invited, as I say, the borough council, district council, the parish council to lay wreaths when we did our service. So we have a congregation of 14 members. If I do a service on a Sunday, we will invariably get between 3 and 8 people. But we decided to do the armistice service on the 11th November, regardless. So that's not the Sunday. It's a weekday, therefore. I think this year it fell on a Thursday. I did it at 3 p.m. rather than 11 a.m. because I realised that all of the established services were on at 11 a.m. But by doing it at 3 p.m., anyone who had a commitment to an existing service was probably free by 3 p.m. And we got 54 people came along. We did it outdoors, and then we went into the chapel in order to light candles, and the children laid their wreaths inside. The children each wrote poems about the war, And one of them, Albert, volunteered to read his poem out. So Armistice Day, usually we do a small service. There's 10 to 20 of us. This year, we did it outdoors. We made it inclusive. We did it at a time people could attend, and we hit more than 50 people. So, you know, that felt like a triumph. Now, in terms of Christmas, it's really hard to make Christmas without a sort of young community at the chapel. And so this year we did lantern making at the school the week before our Christmas service. We did the Christmas service as a carol service. And then in addition, we planted a Christmas tree in the grounds in memory of the eldest member of the village who we had not long before buried. So by making it a sort of family event and making it relevant to a particularly large family in the village, we managed to get 46 people attend that, which I was stunned at and really amazed. And we got the chairman of Derbyshire Dales to come along in his gold chains of office, and the collection was for his air ambulance. But trying to write a service that was relevant for children as well was something I wasn't necessarily used to, but also was great fun because it was slightly chaotic. But it took us beyond our safe space of a Sunday service. The other was we did it in the early evening. I think we did it at 5 p.m. So it felt like it was accessible to mums and dads and didn't intrude on their day. Now, in terms of the chapel, in terms of making it winter friendly and warmer, everyone who's ever been to the chapel knows that it can be uncomfortable. So when we said we wanted to make the chapel warmer, did they have spare cushions? We had a day when people could bring along cushions and things and help us tidy up the chapel. We did mulled wine, made that hot and available. And actually, there were people coming along to help and assist who wouldn't normally engage with the chapel, but were quite willing to try and make it more comfortable in the event that they had used to it. So essentially what I'm doing is trying to find things that are seasonal and relevant to our worship in our calendar year, and then unlock them in a way that enables those who might not think they would engage with the chapel and give them the chance to do so. Now then, the Hucklow teddy bear. This is a bit more of a left field idea, really. I think people come to the chapel, come to the Nightingale Centre, they'll spend 2 or 3 days there, and they leave, particularly if they've been one of the young people, with a really strong sense of joy and engagement with the Peak District. I was then watching things like the repair shop and those sorts of programs and seeing people having huge fond affections for teddy bears that they've been given as children. So you saw the piles of teddy bears in the back of the chapel. What we're about to do, and it will literally commence this weekend, we will give teddy bears to the Nightingale Centre. The housekeeper will be placing a teddy bear on each of the pillows of the children who are coming on Send a Child to Hucklow weekends. And the teddy bear has a tag around its neck, and it says words to the effect of, I'm a previously loved bear, but I have no name. I have no friends and I have no home. Can I be your friend? Can you take me home? Can you give me a name? And the chapel will provide that teddy bear to the Nightingale Centre. The housekeeper will put it out. There'll be some spares so that they can have a gentle squabble over whether it's the teddy bear they want or not. But essentially, they will take something from the chapel at the Nightingale Centre home with them as children. It's about 120 children a year go to Send a Child to Hucklow. So I am now going to be permanently on the lookout for teddy bears. But we've gathered so far about 300 teddy bears. So we think we can get through the next 2 or 3 years fairly easily by giving each of the children who come to Hucklow the Hucklow teddy bear. Now, in addition, it's worth saying we did quite a big quality check on all the teddy bears, make sure they were fireproof, none damaged, none of them have names on, etc. But in addition, it's got two members of the village who have taken up hand-making tags, checking they're in suitable condition, and they are now heavily engaged in the work of the chapel. So the Hucklow teddy bear, one of the more unlikely schemes, I would say, but it has worked in terms of getting us a couple more people engaged in the work of the chapel. Now, I think it's fair to say the Unitarian movement knows the chapel very well, but actually, in terms of telling its own story, the history of the chapel isn't really articulated in it or around it. In unlocking the story of the passing stranger, I think we've begun to tell the story a little bit of what sort of chapel is it. But I think also the chapel has taken stances in the past and over the centuries that are quite interesting. There are four people in the village who have signed up to help us with research in the history of the chapel. Not entirely surprisingly, they're all people who have got ancestry membership. They all do their own family history. Some of them have got access to newspaper research. But we're now going to have a weekend each year where we essentially invite people in to come and tell us their story of the chapel. We start to unlock the story of the chapel, but also do leaflets and insights into it. We've got a book at the back of the chapel that not only lists commemorations of people who've died and buried, but also now records special events that happened at the chapel, whether that's your wedding, whether it's a baptism, or even whether in one case we got the date when a couple met at the Nightingale Centre. They wanted that recorded. So we're now essentially providing things that when people come back, they can either share the history of the chapel with us, or they can tell us their bit of the story and we can add that to it. By having the link with Eam Museum, we're now exploring whether or not that can also be part of the chapel, whether people who visit Eam Museum say you should also go to Great Hucklow Chapel and see this part of the story. And that's something I think that will grow in the future. Now, anyone who knows the chapel knows it's not just the building. We've got quite a garden in front. We have quite a big burial ground at the back, part of which leads up a slope, which has stunning views across the valley. But we've also got a small sort of what I would call garden, like a sort of vegetable garden space next to where the shed is. One of the things we're exploring there is whether or not we can actually have essentially benches which people who are cycling past, walking past, or just visiting can stop, sit, reflect, pause, eat their lunch, have a drink, and just sort of take time to appreciate the chapel and its grounds. I think there's something quite important about making sure that we understand that it's not just about worship, but actually the importance of Hucklow, the importance of its location, the reason why Unitarians chose it for the holiday home, is that actually the very environment in which it sits is nourishing for the soul and good for you. So I want to tell that through the garden, but also through the sheer tranquility of the space. And at the moment, we've got a couple of benches, but they're essentially attached to the burial ground context. What we want to do is to say to people who are walking or cycling past, we're quite happy for you to sit on the wall or sit on the benches and have your lunch. Please feel free and able to come in. Now that's quite a sort of canter through a range of things. But if you look at them back together, I think what we're trying to do and through these projects is articulate who we are, explain why in some ways it's relevant to people who don't think it's relevant to them, have the door open enough spiritually and actually that they can step inside, but also acknowledge that if they can't step inside because of their own perceptions of religion and organized religion, that actually we have events and activities to take place outside. One of the things that was really interesting and bits of feedback we got with the remembrance service for Armistice was people who said, oh, I know, that was a great service. I haven't been inside. Do you mind if I go in? There's a real hesitation there about crossing the door of a church or chapel. And I suppose I'm trying to gradually knock that down and enable people to step inside. I'm fairly assiduous and conscientious at capturing who attends each of our events so that we know and can discreetly, privately, appropriately, where it works, follow it up. But I think the essential element, I would say, is by having these projects, which could apply to a community centre as well as a church in some respects, we are beginning to enable people to engage with us. Now, that's quite a canter around what has been at times quite a lonely 3 years of trying to work out worship at Great Hucklow. But I think hopefully it gives you some insight into what we're trying to do. The other thing I would say is if you look at the photograph on that slide there, it's a metal sort of cast iron heart that we then have tied onto it, crocheted and knitted poppies, and this was for Armistice Day, and then hung behind it a flag of Derbyshire. it was amazing how many people noticed this. And just by using a flag of Derbyshire, it gave us a lot of colour, but also just the flickering of it meant that virtually every single person who passes saw it. Now, of course, being in November, it was quite windy, so actually the flag flies quite a lot. You'll also see there's the old notice board with the poster on it. We've got about six of those posters in a cupboard in the chapel, and I try and change them every month or so, so that anyone passing sees that something has changed each time they come past. I will pause there. I think actually we've got one more slide, I think, with the photographs on. If we just go to the next slide. Yeah. So this gives you an insight into the mad project ideas. So just going along the top, there's Luke, one of our members, with the snowman. It snowed one night very unexpectedly, and so we dashed over there, he and I together, made a snowman. We didn't have a hat, a scarf, two pieces of coal and a carrot, so we went door to door in the village knocking, asking for those. And so after about the fifth house, we finally found someone who had a carrot. We were given a scarf and a hat, and as you can see, the snowman took form. So that was put up very, very quickly. You'll see then the rock snake, where we asked children and adults to paint a rock and add it to our snake. I think we're now up to 37 rocks in our rock snake along the front path. Then we've got the poppy fall, where we asked people to knit poppies, and we hung them on the side of the building. I think we got up to 4,000 knitted poppies this year, and we'll do it again next year. You then, in the bottom left, you can see the children's poems written out, and those are crosses with cut out horses and dogs on them. And we very consciously included poppies that were red, purple, white and black. So it's red for the traditional, it's purple for animals, it's white for peace, and black for to reflect the entire global conflict rather than just European conflict. The next photo, myself, Maud and Peter Rowson with our rainbow umbrella, is essentially an example where if there's a chance to take a good colourful photo, just take it. We weren't really doing anything particular. I happen to have the umbrella with me in the car, but I just think it's important that we capture photos that say something about our ministry. And then here are some of the teddy bears that we've been donated, given and store away. When the children came to the chapel for the armistice service, there was one special needs boy, and he went straight into the chapel, straight over to the teddy bears, and he picked up what you can see there is the stuffed dinosaur. And then we were unable to get the dinosaur from his arms. So when we then started the armistice service, I think we started off with Mr. Chairman, councillors, parents, ladies, gentlemen, and stuffed dinosaurs. And all the children laughed, and a boy with special needs said, "The dinosaur's mine." It just gives it a sense of reality and humanity rather than of silence and reflection. So, Lizzie, I will pause there. That's something of our journey for the last 3 years. You all know Hucklow in many ways much, much better than I, but hopefully that gives you some sense of what we're doing. I hope also some reassurance that what we're doing is well-intentioned, occasionally successful, and when it goes wrong, we try and listen and hear from that. I'll pause there, Lizzie.